For businesses today, storytelling is very important, and it's more important than ever for building community, connections, and growth. We're going to be joined now by the Vice President of Global Business Marketing for Facebook. He's also the Chief Creative Officer of the company. That's Mark Darcy, and he'll be interviewed by Isabel Schnellburger, Chief Strategy Officer at Ogilvy, Germany. Their conversation is going to focus on finding a purpose as a brand. So please welcome to the stage Mark Darcy and Isabel Schnellburger.
Hey, wow. Hi, everyone. My name is Isabel Schnellbügel. I'm Chief Strategy Officer at Ogilvy in Germany. I've been with the company for about 4 years, in the industry for about 10. Before Ogilvy, I've worked for Dropbox and Google, a couple of other agencies. And so my personal focus really is about bringing together creativity, tech, and data to create amazing brand experiences. And next to me is Mark.
He's a much older person.
A little bit older.
A little bit older.
A little bit more experience. He's the Vice President of Global Business Marketing for Facebook and Chief Creative Officer of Facebook. And his role as a Global Business Marketing Vice President, he's responsible for the vision and strategy of marketeers in 16 cities across the globe. And as a global chief creative officer, he's founded the Creative Shop.
Yes.
It's great to have you here.
It's nice to be here. Hello, everyone. It's really nice to be here.
Yeah.
My joke when I'm doing meetings internally at Facebook is I have two titles and one paycheck. But I'll tell you that I've been at Demexco a few years in my former role as just talking about creativity. And I spent 7 years giving advice on stages on how to unlock creativity to do marketing. For the last year, as Isabel said, I've had a marketing role, and I have to say it's much harder to do it than it is to give advice on stages waving your hand around. So I come here with much more empathy on the subject we're talking about, of not only what we should all be doing, but hopefully some ways we can actually do it.
Fantastic. So Mark, let's start with a very simple question. You talked a little bit about your role already. How's it going there?
It's going well. You know, as I said, this transition between I think the building and the advice on stages like this that we all receive and give, we should be doing this. I think in the last year, as I've taken on the business marketing role, is just a much deeper empathy for the stakeholders and the jobs we have to do. And we'll talk about some of that today, particularly around purpose, around as you take on a new role, connecting what you've always done and the purpose and finding that in a new role, which I'm excited to do, you know, and the job for Facebook now.
Perfect. And we're going to talk about this a little bit more, but first let's start with something I think very important. This conference is focused on trust, and Facebook has been in the news quite a little bit around this topic, struggled with a couple of missteps in data and privacy. So what are you doing to really return to trust and give customers and users the trust back?
I mean, it's a critical question. I'm actually really impressed that the entire Congress has been focused on the subject. And for us, it's obviously a critical challenge. And it's a big challenge that we accept and we're working on. The first thing I'd say is that when it comes to rebuilding trust, there's no words on a stage that are gonna do it. I really think that a company like us or any company is gonna be judged and should be judged on their actions. So the various areas you talk about, as far, you know, in terms of trust, I think of the investments over the last 2 years we've been making on the content that's on the site. So 30,000 people, you know, a vast amount of economic investment and the resources, both people and AI, to remove content before anyone sees it. So now whether it's the occurrence or incidence of fake news or hateful speech, we've got things down from 24% before it reaches the platform in 1 year to 65%. So those kind of advancements, if you think of elections, you know, election security from where we were in 2016, where we missed things and we accept that. If you look now, we now have a global system in 50 countries that I think is an industry standard for protecting election integrity. And that's a huge investment that needs to be made and kept up. And if you look at various other areas that we are committed to, whether it's fake accounts, the health and safety of people. We have key focus, investments to improve those in every area and to measure our efficacy. Lastly, I'd just say when it comes to trust and it comes to these issues are bigger than our company, but we take responsibility for hopefully leading that conversation. But there's no finish line to it. Every single thing you bring up, there are actors on the other side innovating and pushing things forward to come at it from a different way, and we constantly have to innovate to keep up. So it'll never be perfect, but we're making huge progress and we're deeply committed to keeping that going.
Okay, and let's talk a little bit about privacy. Privacy is core of many of the issues that you currently have, and it's something that we, especially in Germany, care a lot about that. Is targeted advertising really at odds with privacy?
Targeted advertising?
Yeah.
Well, as I walk through the floor, so many of the booths and the technology companies are talking about this idea of, understanding customers, reaching customers, and the way in which marketing has gone from this anonymous sort of shotgun approach and this evolution we've all been making over the last 20 years to have advertising and marketing be more relevant. I don't think it's about us. I think it's a thing that we've done. And in a lot of ways, it's core to customer expectations of relevance and reward for advertising. But that said, to answer your question, no, I don't think they're mutually exclusive. I think we can and we do have targeted advertising that's relevant and rewarding, and we can protect people's privacy and data. For me, I think it's a big part of it is education. We've this industry, our company as well, have evolved, and we need to make sure there's more communication to people, all of us, so we understand how data is being used, understanding why we're seeing the advertising we're seeing, and giving people way more control of that process, to opt in, to correct, to have choice and control over that. But no, I don't think it is. I think a bigger question that comes up is advertising as a business model. Those of you here that were in Cannes this year, this was a big conversation in Cannes as well, this idea of the role of advertising as a business model. And I'm a huge, as someone who spent 30 years in advertising, I really just believe that advertising is an extraordinary business model for providing a free service for 2.7 billion people. So when I think about the work that I and the team do and we build the advertising solution that provides a free service to 2.7 billion people, I think that's extraordinary. But in addition to that, the business surface, this idea of the potential of these platforms not being able to be used by businesses, large businesses or small businesses, to grow economies, to create jobs, to advance people's ideas into economic opportunity, I think is a hugely positive thing in the world. And we have almost, I think, 90 million businesses now using our business products across the family. A small percentage of them, relative to that size, actually give us any money. Most people are using those services for free. So as the concept of marketing on these platforms and having relevant messages, I think is critical. And I think you can absolutely, and we do both.
Thank you. So you already mentioned relevancy as a topic, and I think that relates really nicely back to our fireside chat topic, which is around purpose. And we're seeing a shift towards purpose again, and I think a lot of brands really try to use it as a way to create relevancy in people's lives every day. So what do you think about this change, and how should brands think about that today?
Yeah, we were talking about this a little bit before we came on stage, and for those marketing nerd historians in the audience, if you look at the founding of a lot of very famous brands, they were founded with extraordinary purpose. I don't think purpose is some new thing, but I definitely think it's caught on as a differentiator. And if you, there's sort of two aspects to this, I think. I think if you we do look at the research, I'm sure many of you looked at the research. Millennials, Gen X will, say that they'll spend more money, they'll go out of their way to connect with brands that identify with the things they care about. And that's one thing. I think the other thing is we just have an infinite choice, almost infinite choice, in so many categories now of the brands we can choose, in almost any vertical or category you care to name. So when we're making those choices, the ability to pick a brand that identifies, whether with a social cause or an environmental, whatever it may be, it could be anything you like, gives us that power to differentiate a brand. I think the third part of it is on platforms like ours, you have the ability to have a more textured dialogue around not just what your brand says, but where it's coming from. So back in the day, there wasn't the paint and canvas to tell nuanced stories around your supply chain to people who cared about it as overtly. You had to tell a narrative form, you had a very short amount of time, and you had to simplify the story. But now I think brands can tell more textured stories around what they are. And this is small companies that have started with purpose and large brands that are looking for significance. Now, the downside of this, and this is what we're also talking about, I'm sure many of you see this in work, is where large brands in particular try and bolt on purpose to differentiate themselves like a condiment. Like, we're kind of plain, I think we'll co-opt this purpose and bolt it on our brand. And people see through that in a second, right? That just isn't true. So you can only take a stand for something you stand for. You can only stand for something you've actually done something with. So credibly aligning the mission of your company with the purpose and then investing behind it is the first step, not marketing it. And I think we have to be very cautious of that in the way we pursue purpose as a marketing platform.
Okay. So can you give examples of brands here in Germany and globally that you think are doing this really well, aligning their purpose, aligning what they stand for with their communications and also their actions?
Yeah, well, as I said, I think many of you in this room probably own businesses that you've started with a purpose. You have family members that have one, and that small business kind of energy, that enormous leap entrepreneurs make when they risk their mortgage or they do whatever they need to start a business, so many of them now, in so many different ways, are started with this drive above economics. People want to do something, whether it's a small business or a business they want to take on the world with, they're defined by their purpose. So there were a lot. There's one I was told about as I was coming to Germany, Jan June, a fashion company, I don't know whether you know it, in Hamburg, with two female entrepreneurs that have started it in an antidote to fast fashion, in their own words, to really talk about the ethical sourcing and payment of who's making your clothes. And they use Instagram really well, both feed and stories, to talk about the subject in great detail and to celebrate, you know, the ethical way that their fashion is made. And so anywhere in the world, any category, I can show you examples of people who have taken this idea that could have been a small idea and created huge audiences because people deeply care about the subject they're talking about. But again, it's not just small businesses. I have a privileged job that I work with most of the large companies in the world and have done for a long time. And I'm sure many in the room do as well. And if you talk to senior business leaders across companies like Unilever or Procter & Gamble or any you care to name, but I'll hit on Unilever for a second. They are deeply driven by purpose. Alan Jope, the CEO, is committed that, you know, they will only invest long-term with brands that are deeply committed to a purpose for a better world. And that dominates all of our conversations with them. And it's a significant one. And I would say overall, in all of marketing communication, a thing everybody can do is really focus on the inclusiveness and diversity that we put into our communication. You know, it's the one simple thing we can do to make sure the people we're depicting in our advertising, the people who are shooting our commercials, that are making our work, are as diverse as the people we're serving. Because as an industry, we still have a long way to go. The panels on a stage, the way we are showing up at shoots, all of us can change that. So if there's one common purpose I think the marketing industry can focus on, it's that.
Yeah, and I absolutely agree. I think diversity is an important topic.
Yeah. A friend of mine was just saying there's too many mantles. You need panels with diversity.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. And I think that's especially a topic that's relevant in Germany as well. I think there are a couple of brands here that have taken on this topic. Like, for example, Katjes is an example that's really shown a more diverse casting in their advertising, which I think is something that is extremely important.
Yeah. What brands do you like in Germany? I mean, you're here. You live in this market. What brands do you admire?
So I think from a global perspective, a brand that I've seen do things and really come from a purpose, also in the fashion industry actually, and in the beauty industry, is Fenty by Rihanna.
Yeah.
It's a brand that really embraces the diversity of women and shows them in all their shapes, sizes, and colors. And that this is not only reflected in the in the personality of the founder, but also in the products and in the way they communicate and the fashion shows they're doing. And I think this is something that could create a movement and influences the wider conversation as well.
Yeah, it's interesting with that. I think one of the things that if you think of the change just in how we see imagery, one of the things I talk about a lot is, like, historically there were very few people who had the power of a camera to take photos of people and say, this is what we should look at, this is right, this is wrong, this is good, this is bad. And I think one of the things, because our audiences, all of our audiences anywhere in the world, are making more content than we are, they are framing their own lives, they are telling their story. the opportunity for brands to embrace the diversity of their audience more and see opportunity in that is quite profound. And it changes this narrow lens that we've sort of historically grown up with. We're like, this is what someone should look like, or this is right, this is wrong. And it's thrown that out the door. And we're sort of seeing this diversity explode across a lot of areas, including fashion. It's fantastic.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and I think on the other hand, it's also a big struggle for big companies that are, looked at advertising in a very one-sided way in the past, and how to really embrace this, storytelling that's very diverse and it comes from the consumers themselves.
Yeah, and the best ideas. I had the opportunity last year to judge the awards in Cannes, the social influencer, and the big question is like, the marketing campaigns that are changing culture. So many of us are like, how can I have an idea that's going to, shape culture? And if you look at the commonality of the ones that actually work, all of them are not designed to shape culture. They're ideas that are designed to be shaped by culture. And that transfer, this idea, this humility that we need as creators and marketers to say, our audience has the same technology we do. They are not passive consumers. They are co-contributors. And ideas that do that are the ones that just take off, because they're not what we put out. It's what, it's the co-development of both of those things. And it's a core part, and generally they are also defined by purpose, because that's what gets people excited.
Yeah, so it's really about taking the risk to give some of the things that we do into the hands of the consumers.
Yeah, it's scary.
It is.
Yeah, it's scary, because we're used to being in absolute control, locking down an edit, that's what it is. But so many of them are shaped, even if you maintain, it's not about user-generated content or any specific craft element, it's really a philosophy that this thing I'm putting into the world is not going to be exactly as I intended. It's going to move where people are going to take it, and I'm going to have a dialogue with them through these platforms.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And I think, I think we've seen brands do it here in Germany as well.
Yeah.
So we, for example, work with Coca-Cola, which is also a brand that has a purpose at heart, bringing together people, bridging divides. And we've done this this little stunt in Berlin for the Christopher Street Day 2019, where we produced cans that said "Love Can," so which is a pun on the word can.
Yeah.
We also, decorated the city with messages celebrating love instead of hate. But in the end, it was really about giving to a community, the tools and letting them own the dialogue.
Yeah. Well, that again is a huge aspect that we see, across Facebook and Instagram from marketers, where they're like, in addition to the craft that we can talk about around how to build, this idea of finding communities that really matter to you, or you really matter to them, and then doing things like you did in Berlin to astound them, to actually do things that are magical. And I often think of it as simply as like spending your marketing budget the way your audience wishes you would, and looking at opportunities to have people go, that's just fantastic. That is just amazing that you did that. That's wonderful. That kind of energy, that kind of gift, that kind of generosity, it's just wonderful, and it creates all sorts of opportunities to create content and do marketing stuff, but it's really, the heart of it is one driven by purpose and a community to astound.
Yeah.
It's really good.
Exactly. So it's all about bringing together purpose with openness, with also involving audiences.
Yeah. And action.
And
actually
action.
Doing something, advertising, is purely, historically we had these narrative forms. I grew up doing this. You'd write a narrative form, some metaphor to tell a story about how you wanted somebody to feel. But now marketing, great marketing, and again, you look through this Congress and the companies that help enable this stuff, it's like amazing customer service. It's amazing experiences in the real world that you capture and then can use platforms like ours or others to telegraph, those stories. But it starts with action. It's not enough just to tell a metaphor. You have to be doing things that are going to touch people in the real way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, we sometimes still need to do push advertising.
Yeah.
We still need to put messages in front of people.
Sure.
In a way that's a little bit old school, maybe.
Well, I don't know. I don't know. I think one of the things with old school is. No matter what the medium, television, any medium in the world, the biggest shift that I've seen in the last, half decade is this need for us as marketers, as creative directors, whatever role we play in this industry, to have this deep humility that our audiences have infinite choice total control and zero cost of movement of ignoring us. And so many of us have grown up with this stubborn kind of belief that because I'm paying money, that person's gonna watch this thing, or that person, like I, this is the power. Nonsense. People have, all of us, anyone with a mobile phone has unbelievable freedom to look somewhere else, do something else at any moment, and our job is to have the humility to say we have to reward attention, we have to earn attention, no matter what the surface is. So the question of old school, I think, is broken down into a real need to change not just what we do, but how we build it from the ground up.
So the question I would have here is how do brands keep up? We talked about consumers have the tools. They're probably better equipped than we are as marketeers and advertising agencies. So how can we keep up with that?
Yeah, it is. I mean, as I said, I've got more empathy for this answer than you probably know. I think the way we look at it and the way I talk about it a lot is four major shifts, right? The first one is one I just sort of touched on, but I'll repeat it, is around curation. So this simply is, we've historically had a media plan and we've built things and we've put them into the world because that's what we were doing. But if you start with a curatorial point of view, you look at whoever you want to reach and you have an absolute focus on where they are, where they're spending time, and building for those opportunities. There's no we used to do it this way, this is what we've always done. You're absolutely focused on the reality of the world you live in and where those people are. The second part of designing for those surfaces is you don't have the right, we don't have the right as marketers to say, well, this is what I want to do, so I'm going to jam it into this paint or this canvas. We have to design with the language and grammar, as my dear friend Nick Law uses the term, of that space. So if you're in stories or you're in feed or you're in television or you're in print, whatever that surface is, you need to astound people with what they want to see in there if you're going to have any chance of standing out. And that is, you're marketing in that way. The second thing is around community. I sort of touched on this. What we're seeing on Facebook in particular, but we see this across the world, is the connections between friends and family being augmented and enriched with people coming together around things they're passionate around. It could be a cause, it could be a passion like good beer, just saying. It could be any number of things. Cars, old cars in my case, any number of things. Those connections, those communities are incredibly powerful from the point of view of where people are spending their time online. And again, gives huge opportunities for brands to identify them that are connected either directly to their brand or, and location-wise, whatever it may be, and really astound them and serve them. The last two are conversation. Again, in the booth today, I saw the power of conversational commerce, the power of conversation in what I like to think of as making all businesses, giving them the power to feel like small businesses. The lovely exchange you have at your local shop, that intimacy, that kind of connection, messaging gives that power. And lastly, commerce. All of us are so demanding, and we see something, we want to buy it. We have this expectation now of excellence in the ability to get things to our home or whatever the service offering may be. And I think as marketers, a huge part of what we have to focus on is that zero friction design that goes from seeing something to buying it as easily as possible and really maintaining those systems. Those four things are really the shifts that we see marketing built from. And if we commit to them, we're doing marketing for people and we're not doing marketing at people. We're not saying this is what we want to do. We're building it from the people out.
Yeah.
Yeah. But again, awesome. It's harder to do than it is to say on stage.
Exactly, yeah. It's a big shift in the industry. It's not only about understanding data, understanding customers better, understanding technology, but also having a completely different mindset in the way you approach things.
Yeah, and I think it's making sure all these things serve the idea, serve the purpose of what you're trying to do. I think if we try and tick boxes on, I'm using this technology, or Facebook said they had this thing, so I should totally use it. So it's got to be the other way around. You've got to use this stuff for a good reason to do something amazing. Otherwise, you end up chasing your tail and doing things just for the sake of it because someone told you. It has to be driven around that purpose of serving people.
Yeah. And you as a creative also know the power of big ideas. In the end, it's still about creativity. in the way we talk to people. It's still about the fantastic ideas.
Well, I think it is, but I do think the big idea is changing, because we can have different big ideas around our purpose that show up in different ways for different reasons. As I said, I think because we have a multitude of screens and services and connection points, we have a way to have nuanced storytelling or build utilities that manifest the idea or the thing we're building towards in different ways. The mistake of the big idea is taking the big idea, taking it from one medium and jamming it into every other, you know, surface and saying I've scaled my big idea. I think the big ideas need to be centered around something that can actually be unlocked really well in every touch point. So you're like, oh, it's different, but I see the connection. So it's not fragmented, it serves a common goal, but it's done, as I said, it's curated for that experience.
So this means creativity itself is also changing.
100%, and coming from different places. It's not just a writer and an art director. They come from a huge, you know, data scientist, you know, craft, you know, filmmakers, artisans, people who don't look like traditional creatives have a huge impact on how things, you know, can be built.
Okay, perfect. Yeah. I think we're pretty much out of time, but I want to ask you one last question, which is, we talked about purpose a lot.
Yeah.
For brands, for marketers, for people. What's your purpose to come to work every day? Another easy one.
It's an easy one, I guess, but it's a different answer than I would have given a year ago. So a year ago, I would have told you, as in my creative role, it's what I've sort of always believed creativity does, which is, you know, creativity is just to me a business tool for unlocking the potential of something to create value. I think it's just you look at something and a creative person, and again, I've got a very broad sweep of what I think of creativity, but creativity unlocks this potential to come up with an idea that goes, and it creates something of value. And that's what I did for a long time. Now, and it sort of gets back to my earlier answer around why I work at Facebook and why I do this job, is these platforms, these technologies, you know, have enormous potential that people are unlocking in the world. And when we talk about being for everyone, we mean everyone. And I think my role is in running business marketing is to make them available for everyone in the world so that anyone anywhere with an idea can have a shot at having the idea reach somebody without it costing it. Like, just have a way to put that idea into the world. And if you want to get noble, if you want to feel about it in that way, if you look at human history, most people in most places, either geography, economically, whatever it may be, haven't had that shot. So the stories that inspire me are the ones that you see every day all over the world of people for the first time in history, for them, having this opportunity. And that's amazing. And that's a reason to come to work. And that's why I do.
Fantastic last words. Thank you very much.
Thanks for having me.
Sure.
All right, we're going off this way? After you.
So. Thank you.
A huge thank you to Isabella and Mark for that very insightful conversation there today. Now, Facebook, of course, started out as an idea. Every entrepreneur who has an idea is very passionate about driving it forward. We've got many entrepreneurs outside in the Future Park, so if you want to go and check them out, I'm sure they would love your support and feedback on any ideas that they have. Of course, it may well be the Facebook of tomorrow. Do join us in a few minutes when we're going to have a keynote speech and fireside chat with the head of EMEA at YouTube. See you in a few.